Dog is Family on Berks Community Television is underwritten by Answers Pet Food.
Dog is Family on BCTV is supported by Godfrey's. Welcome to Dogdom. Welcome to our show, Dog is Family. My name is Barb Emmett, and I'm your producer and host for this show. It's a show where we celebrate the bond we share with our dogs. We love them like family, and that's why the show is Dog is Family. We explore their lifestyle. We explore nutrition. We bring on interesting guests that can share their world of their dogs with you. We like to do thought-provoking topics, too. We like you to get thinking and how different ways are that you can bring your dog into your world. I am a dog mom. I now have one of those golden retrievers in the beginning named Charlie, and he works with us at Godfrey's Welcome to Dogdom. And we are here today with a wonderful lineup for you. I think you're going to have a blast with it. I know I am. And I know we're talking about Earth Day, and we're talking about connections and getting connected with our Earth. And boy, does this guest and his dog do this. I'll read you a real quick quote, and then we're going to get on with our guest. The more clearly we can focus our attention on the wonders and realities of the universe about us, the less taste we shall have for destruction. That was by Rachel Carson, the biologist and author, and many of you probably know of her. And I think that Mike and his dog Peri really do live and breathe this philosophy, and he can tell you what all of this does for his life. So I'm going to look over here, and here is Mike. Hi, Mike. Mike Pease.
Hello.
Hello. And this is his dog Peri, and he's being such a wonderful boy. And Mike and I met through Godfrey's, but there's a lot of story and a lot of parallel, and every time he comes in the store, boy, do we talk. There are many common topics, aren't there, Mike?
Keep you there late on a lot of Tuesdays.
Yes, he does. Yes. He does. Mike is a local guy. Perry's a local guy. And Mike is home with his wife, Amy, and his family. But I'm going to turn it over to Mike on why we're here today, how his life began to change. You've seen the topic is Vizsla Vision and how one dog changed and brought you two simple joys in life. Right, Mike?
Yes.
Tell us the beginnings, and you have a Vizsla. Like, tell us why, how, what happened.
So, I also have three children that are 23, 21, and 14. And my two daughters kept me very busy on weekends with sports. So there really wasn't a whole lot of time for a pet or a dog at the time.
You didn't have any pets then?
We did not.
Okay.
They begged for them quite frequently.
Oh, okay.
But we knew we just didn't have the time to dedicate to it. So as they got older and the sports, began to end as they were getting ready to go to college, I also happened to switch jobs at the time and started working from a home office.
Ah.
So after a few weeks, it became apparent that it was now going to be an opportunity to bring a dog into our life and be able to dedicate the time and effort to training a puppy and making sure that it was done properly and we had the time to do it. So,
how did you pick this breed and why?
So, I've always been into the outdoors. I've liked hiking, used to do a lot of mountain biking and kayaking in my younger days, and still enjoyed doing it. And thought, now that I've got these weekends free, and as long as my wife wasn't giving me a list of chores, I'd be outdoors a little bit more. And the Vizsla, I started looking into different breeds and with athleticism and outdoors. And the Vizsla is by nature a bird hunting dog, so they love to be outdoors. They are very active, have great endurance. They also are very family oriented, as he's demonstrating right now.
I'm sorry, folks, but this is just too precious.
they can be a little bit energetic. So they're maybe not the best around real small children. just because they don't know, you know, kind of their own strength sometimes. But as far as a loving family dog, their nickname is actually the Velcro dog.
It is.
It's because they are constantly stuck to you. You know, when we watch TV or just sitting around in the evening, he has to be touching somebody.
Oh, is that right?
So it could even just be a paw on your foot or on your leg. No, come here.
The cup.
Yeah, the cup. Come here. But yeah, so with just the outdoors and activities, I thought, you know, this did a lot of research, spent a couple months, read several books, talked to different people, and realized that they are high energy, take a lot of work, you know, to keep them active. But he seemed to fit our lifestyle.
He also seems to fit the camera, folks. Don't you think he really is enjoying being on television today? Peri, you're a natural. So you did a lot of work. You had to figure out, if I'm getting a Vizsla, how do I find a breeder who is dedicated to the breed, and you felt that you would make a good decision, right?
Yeah. And we actually, I mean, I know people that have gone far and wide to get them.
Sure.
And we found...
I did too, yeah.
Calvaresi, who's up in Burnville.
Okay.
He breeds Vizslas and Ridgebacks, and this is, you know, was Calvaresi Vineyard. So I guess after the vineyard was sold, he found a new passion, one that he had always had for dogs, and began breeding the two breeds, the Vizsla and Ridgeback.
Is he still breeding? You don't know?
I think he might be, but I think he was kind of maybe on his way out. Yeah. So I don't know if he is still today.
So we're not adding a second Vizsla right now, huh?
I don't know if I could afford a second Vizsla.
Yeah, let's talk reality about cost and care at some point. Yeah. But yeah, isn't that the truth? Oh my gosh. Well, he is just loving this mic. I can't believe how much he's so good. We want to get into one of the other topics, folks, since Mike, you can tell already that he researches and he wants to learn and he wants to explore. And he came at the perfect time in your life.
Yeah.
Okay, and also you started food and health. What was
going on
in your head then?
So, of course, you know, like most people, when you're getting a puppy from a breeder, you have those several weeks of time, and I'm not a very patient person, so I got to fill that time with something.
I didn't know that.
So I obsessed over bringing them home and how are we going to care for them
and
just the lifestyle. And, you know, not I had a dog a long time ago, but nothing for 20-some years. So I started researching food because I knew how that had changed over 2 decades and came across the raw diet. And the more I read into it, I was intrigued by it and saw the benefits. And I mean, the science, I think, and just the health aspects speak for themselves. But there was also, you know, it's a lot of work if you're feeding raw and going to the butcher and trying to make the meals yourselves. And I'll be honest, I was just a little too lazy with that.
You have to care about balance.
Exactly.
You have to know exactly what you're doing to make your own food. So.
And that is beyond me. I mean, there's certain things that I understand and I can grasp, very visual person, but food science, it's all, you know, it's not something I can see and touch. So through that research, I came across Answers, which is, I guess, out of Fleetwood, and obviously you guys are, it's kind of what led me to Godfrey's. As I came across them, you know, I had driven past Godfrey's for many, many years.
And you came in the door, and I think we had Answers about 2 years by then, and I had converted my Goldens to what I liked about Answers, small, local, transparent, and sourcing, how they were raising all of the animals used in the food, and safe with their patented process to keep bacteria at a nice, safe level and actually help the gut. And so Mike comes walking in, and it was probably, we had other folks on Answers at the time, of course, as we've gotten to educate more people about the benefits of it, but you came in and you're like, I have a puppy and I want to do this. Well, I think he was the first puppy we did get to. He and a yellow lab, a couple of yellow labs from another one of our customers who said, I want to do better and I'm going to do this. And so we really had to kind of work, I remember, because his metabolism was so high that he didn't fit the food calculator for puppy growth, right?
Yes,
can you
correct.
Speak about
I'm
that?
Impressed you remembered that. Yeah.
Oh, I'll never forget because I was like, okay, we're going to do this. We're starting a puppy. This is different than starting an adult, and let's be careful.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, it was. I forget exactly what it was, but it was we increased it it was almost 1.5 times what was recommended.
Yeah, so that was learning for me too, folks, as I was, you know, building this and working with it. And with Micah, he's ready to go without, like, hesitation. He'd done his research. He knew what he wanted. And, oh, Peri started. And how did he take to that in your food journey as you figured, this is what I want to do for this new babe?
So I know there's like a transition period and we had to watch because he was on, you know, whatever the breeder had him on. So there was the transition, but he was digestive wise was taking to it extremely well. And by 10 weeks, after only 2 weeks, he was fully transitioned to answers. And
wow,
he'll be 4 in about 2 months and he's been on it ever since.
And your vet supported. Interestingly enough, we always talk about you want that the veterinarian you go to understand what you're doing and support it. And you did have that support.
Yeah, and I originally started with a vet who I had experience with previously and was, after the first puppy visit, was not happy with, I guess, the way things went. And I ultimately ended up switching to Dr. Moran at Willow Creek
because
she's holistic. And,
You
know, so everybody has their own
views
and opinions on things, but
I
just felt as though I'm not, I didn't want to do all the vaccinations that were optional and felt as though with his diet and the right, you know, lifestyle that some of that may not be necessary. And fortunately, knock on wood, he's been extremely healthy. Not to get too personal, but his bowel movements have never been anything other than what they should be. You know, they've always been solid, regular.
He's had perfect poop. Yeah. Let's see. Perfect poop, Peri. Okay, Peri. Oh, my gosh.
The only health incident we ever had, and again, I just don't give him the chewables or the flea and tick medication. I use like some natural, and I do sometimes forget. He did end up developing and contracted Lyme disease. Didn't know it, except for we found the tick one day, went and got him tested, and you know he was asymptomatic.
Good.
We continue to get the blood work and urine tests every so many months, and they continue to be normal levels.
Yeah,
so
proactively checking if there's a flare, you treat.
Yes.
Yeah, so he's been really, really healthy, and we just love the journey. I know, I think it's just been very cool. I know when we talk about things, you're talking about like the gut, you're talking about the poop, you're talking about energy level. And wait, folks, you're going to see the energy level of this boy. I mean, like, he is like a beautiful, well-structured boy. So do you want to get into lifestyle or do you want to talk any more about food and nutrition and health and lifestyle? You made a commitment about all these things and then you started lifestyle exploring, right?
Yes. So
lead us on because there's some wild, I've never, and this is, I feel so excited to bring Mike and Peri here because every time he'd tell us stories, I'd be like, your stories need to be told. Like people need to understand how they can live with their dogs in a very natural way, in a way that seeks breaking out of the barrier where we're at and going for it. So, Mike, please lead us on. You have beautiful photos. We're going to see some fun videos, too. You won't believe it.
So, I did, through my research while I was waiting to bring him home, you know, I was careful during his growth stage not to go too far, too fast, too hard early on because of the growth and the
growth
development
plates.
And bones and and the joints. So
he was well aware.
You know, took him on short walks. We live in near the shop near Noldy Forest. So I'd take him over there on short walks just to get him acclimated outdoors and, you know, it also allowed me to get outdoors at the same time. But then once he got to be around a year old and was mostly fully grown, which I don't know that he would ever stop because he's very large for the breed. But then we started our journeys with longer, more strenuous types of hikes and introduced him. He's a hunting dog. He actually has webbed feet, so he's very adept at swimming. So introduced him to water at an early age. And, you know, I just got him acclimated to the outdoors and the things that I was hoping we'd spend a long time doing. And
he's, it's amazing. Why don't you lead us through pictures? He's got a whole picture collection, and we'll talk through hikes, water, mountain biking, caves. Got some pictures. And go ahead and start it
sure.
up.
Sure. So, all right. Yeah. So, this was his first hike when he was just about a little over a year old. And people from Berks County are probably very familiar. It's Pinnacle and Pulpit up above Hamburg. The one thing I learned with him early on was, you know, you can trust him pretty well. And what I mean by that is, you know, you can see this photo. He's on the edge of quite an overlook and a cliff.
I would be a nervous mama. I'd be like, oh, my gosh.
And Amy is as well when I show her the picture.
My wife Amy's like, what were you what doing?
Is he going to fall? He's going to jump. But, I mean, he's not going to intentionally put himself in harm's way. And okay. I keep an eye on things. I'm very conscious of the surroundings and aware of what's happening around us. We typically like to go out early in the morning and hikes where there's not a lot of other people because I can allow him to kind of do it as, you know, to run freely. And I know often places I'm breaking the rules on that because there are leash laws in some of the parks and state parks I go to, but I'm also respectful if there's a lot of people around, I do put them on leash. But I do like to get out early before most people are on the trails for that reason. Okay. It also helps eliminate, you know, some of the places we go, there are snakes, and of course they come out midday to sun on the rocks. So by the time that's occurring, we're typically done hiking. You know, we've already been out and done
early hikes, getting going, which is beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah, and sometimes, you know, you might get out for sunrise, you'll get to see a lot more nature and wildlife, which we've seen our fair share, and he's been curious. But
what do we got?
Yeah, so I won't go through every photo just and narrate, but, you know, just sunrise up in Delaware Water Gap.
Okay.
You know, and it's funny because my kids joke and say that I take more pictures of Peri than I have collectively of them, and there's...
I don't think that's a surprise.
A lot of truth to that,
a lot of truth to that, and it's okay. They're older kids. They can accept
That's right. And I tell them he's more photogenic anyway.
Yeah, there you go. I don't think they're going to want to hear that. Aw. What are we looking at?
So... I think he's also part mountain goat to some degree. I mean, the rock climbing and stuff that, and I don't rock climb like ropes and harness and all of that, but just some
but
of these small
steep.
Cliffs and steepness. Yeah, he's very good at climbing.
Does that help climbing?
Not with the climbing, I think it's just, you know, the strength. And it's interesting to watch. It's, you know, when we go hiking, we'll do 8 to 12 miles on average. So I'm in the woods 3 to 4 hours. And it's a great opportunity to just kind of clear your mind, which is really what he has helped me do, because I do work, I'm in commercial construction, so it's not stressful and strenuous from a standpoint of, you know, all negativity, but there's constant things happening. So weekends are my opportunity to just kind of clear my head and get away from everything that goes on during the week. And he's helped me with that because it's interesting when you're out there, just you and your dog, you start observing things and picking up on things that you normally don't notice during the normal hustle of the 9-to-5 work week.
It's like your eyes are wide open. All of a sudden, you can shut out the noise of what's going on.
Exactly. And it's...
And your conscious.
It's almost like therapeutic.
It's therapeutic.
It is. You feel refreshed and...
Honey, I didn't bring cookies to see what you brought. Today. I didn't bring cookies. I will get you your little gift cookie bag that way.
So,
no, that's an important point. I think everybody needs to hear that when you're doing what you're doing and you're pursuing that, like, you can let it go.
Yeah, and whatever that release may be, you know, for me, it's hiking and being outdoors, and he helps me to do that. And he also forces me to get out because I have an obligation to him, you know, to get him out and get him running and give him exercise because... You know, there's many a times you wake up and say, the heck with it, I'm rolling over and going back to sleep, or
Absolutely.
It's cold, or it's raining, or it's, you know, I just don't feel like it, but, you know.
And you still get up. See, that's the thing. You
I do.
Still
and he
push yourself.
Helps me do that,
yeah.
I mean, oftentimes we're leaving the house before dawn. You know, we're leaving at 4:30 in the morning, and it's a 2-3 hour drive to where we go sometimes. And
folks, it doesn't have to be right here. He's going out and exploring and... That I find that amazing that you, wow, Peri, I guess there's something to climb up there. Maybe he thinks he should be climbing. I don't know.
Yeah.
But, I mean, that is awesome. He gets you going because does he let you know if it's been a while, if you haven't been out? Or do you know how important it is to
him? We know because the energy,
yeah. Okay.
Yeah. And he actually, for the breed, he's surprisingly calm in the house. Because a lot of times, you know, this breed, the zoomies,
yeah,
you know, they're running around and they're bouncing off the wall.
And they're energetic. They're
he has found, and I've noticed, is when he starts getting that nervous energy.
Okay, he'll be, what does he do?
He chews on his toys. Oh. And you'll see him go and get them out of his little basket.
Ah.
And you just see the strength of his chewing is releasing his energy.
It's a higher anxiety, like a...
Yeah, it's not just playing or just leisurely. It's he's working off some of that energy.
And then Daddy says, I think we better go for a hike.
Yes.
Oh, my gosh.
And we do try to get out every weekend.
Every weekend.
It's, you know, we can't always, but I at least get him out, I say, every weekend. We don't always go on long hikes or excursions every weekend. But every weekend we are out, you know, burning off some energy. It might just be at a blue marsh, you know, for a few miles and, you know, an hour or two just to let him run.
And I give your family credit because there's always so much work to be done at home as well. So Amy out there, wow, what a gift.
Yes.
That, you know, we can pursue in our relationships what we need to do and with them. So it helps the whole family when Peri's happy, right? That's what we always say. When my dog's happy, everybody's happy.
That's
when
right.
When my dogs are tired, yay, it's a good day because we did right by them.
Yes. And a tired dog is a happy dog.
And I know
it makes
you said
a happy
that.
Family.
Yes, and you said that right from the beginning one time, and I'm like, oh my god, that's been my mantra. Like, tired dog done right, like this is a happy dog. Yeah. Well, keep showing us some photos. Let's get into these adventures.
Right. So, I've always kayaked.
I love it.
I've
look at him standing.
A couple of kayaks, but they were the sit-in style.
Okay.
And I learned early on, even with the tandem, getting a 75-pound dog into a kayak was a challenge. So
the sitting did not work for you. You need
to get him up over and down inside.
Okay.
Because for my leverage, I couldn't, everything was just twisting and turning. But with fishing kayaks, where he can walk around like you see here, it's much easier.
He doesn't have a balance problem or anything. He just seems like he's happy up there.
Oh, yeah. And that's pretty much, he's at the bow and, you know, leading the way.
Wow. Yeah, it looks like it. Captain.
Just, again, being a water dog. The life vest early on was precautionary because, you know, we had been swimming off of the shore quite a bit. But going out in the middle of a lake, I wanted to make sure and just kind of observe. And it also helped because there was a handle on the back.
But yeah, lift him up.
But as he got older... You know, we rarely use that anymore.
Is he up on the mountain? What is? Oh, there.
Yeah,
he is.
Yeah. It's just another overlooking the mountains. I don't know if you can see this on the television, but on we talk about the wildlife we've seen. That's a beaver, which we stood and watched for about 20 minutes.
He could just stand and watch without getting.
I had to give him several commands, but
eventually,
I think he gave in and realized, you know, he wasn't going out to chase it. Which I don't think he would have done very well against that beaver. He was pretty large.
Yeah, that would be... Oh, was he big? Was he?
Yes, yeah.
Do you know where that one was? You don't know.
Sunfish Pond up in Delaware Water Gap.
Oh.
I mean, you couldn't see it in the photo, but about 10 feet off to the right was the beaver dam.
Oh, my gosh.
And we actually ended up seeing a second one come out later. But,
now what are we doing here?
Just a bridge. You know, there's not many things that he's hesitant or afraid to do. As long as, you know, sometimes he just needs that motivation or just the reassurance to go ahead and do it.
And you just...
But that was just a log bridge that, you know, he cruises right across going over to creeks.
Wow.
He's not afraid to go upstairs.
Wow. Isn't that something? I mean, and were you ahead of him? You were behind him.
I'm behind,
taking
the
picture. So.
Yeah, I'm rarely ahead
of him.
He
just goes.
Which is another nice thing with the breed. They typically like you within their sight.
Okay.
And he will not... go usually more than 30 or 40 feet ahead of where I am, unless there's a squirrel or something that he's chasing. But so he's always in my line of sight.
Some
waterfall, rapids. He loves going in the water. Doesn't matter what time of year, whether it's the middle of summer or there could be a foot of snow on the ground, he's still in the water.
He'll go in the water.
He still goes in the water. Which is surprising because the Vizsla is a single coat.
Yes, it's a single coat.
I mean, he's... I don't know, half inch long hair, and
he didn't freeze or come out shivering.
No.
What? Maybe he had already
again.
Like,
I think
up
the metabolism. Yeah.
Oh my gosh! Pity.
I do have a coat that when it's below freezing, he'll wear. But most of the time, he's either, as you see him today, or he does have that orange vest, which you'll see quite a bit.
Does he? Do his paw pads get nicked up while he's hiking?
They do
a
little bit,
pad.
But surprisingly. And again, this is to each their own. I don't take them on walks through the neighborhood. because what I found was he's always pulling. And sidewalks and the asphalt, he would get very rough on his pads.
Ah.
Hiking, I have done very little for his pads. Other than in the winter when it's freezing out, I do put that musher's wax just to prevent snow and ice from sticking. But that's pretty much the extent
of it. He doesn't
rip them up? No. Well, and I think, again, a lot of it is because he's free to run. So there's nothing restricting him and holding him back where he's got that, the resistance.
That makes sense.
So it allows him to just move at his pace and, again, trust that he knows what is okay for him and what's not, and he's going to respond on his own.
So you never had to wear the rough wear boots or any kind of boot?
No.
But in this climbing, we're going to see. He doesn't have to wear that. Let's see. There's more to come.
Yes, this is just a lot of the place. I mean, for anybody that doesn't go hiking in Pennsylvania, the Appalachian Trail, anybody that hikes it, they refer to Pennsylvania as Rocksylvania.
Okay.
Because it is just a ton of rocks, a lot of granite, and very sharp. The rocks in Pennsylvania are different than a lot of the geology in other areas of the country where they're more rounded or flat. Pennsylvania is very, it's very rigid and pointy.
Interesting.
So a lot of through hikers on the Appalachian Trail will say that it's the worst section of hiking.
I didn't know
that.
What's he doing? What are we doing there?
That was just overlooking the,
Is that Blue Marsh?
Susquehanna River.
Oh, the Susquehanna.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I wanted to say Schuylkill.
He's been
to sometimes he poses nicely for photos.
Yeah.
Exploring a waterfall.
Oh my goodness, that's beautiful. Now, does he drink?
I always take water along.
Yeah.
No matter where I'm going. Very often I come home with a full bottle because he'll just drink out of the creek or streams or puddles. And and we were talking about observation, just an interesting thing that I observed with him drinking out of streams. I always used to think he was kind of, I'd call him a knucklehead because he'd go into the water, he would turn around and all the mud and silt that he stirred up was now flowing downstream and he would be facing downstream when he was drinking. So all that
was mucked
disturbance,
up.
Was flowing what he was drinking. And I've noticed it numerous times. Well, I don't know where I read it, but I came across that dogs don't drink the way we do. Their tongues don't fold forward. They fold backwards when they collect the water.
Yes.
Which then the light bulb went off that if he were facing upstream and trying to collect the water, it's running away from the direction that his tongue folds. So the reason he's spinning around is he's capturing the water
getting
as it's flowing.
Water.
Yeah.
Isn't
so
that
it's just,
interesting?
Again, little the escape from reality and things that you pick up on when you're in the woods for hours by yourself.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, that's so interesting. Where are we going, Pear? What's this?
There you can see he's waiting for me. My daughter was along for the hike the one day, so once in a while I'll get some other pictures where I'm actually in them. Of course, this was all the same day that she was along.
Beautiful.
There you just see some of the rock formations.
Look at that. I did not realize there was
so much. He's off leading the way.
Wow. Dogs being dogs.
This is...
Oh, what does that say?
It's just a warning sign. It's a hidden gem in southern... I think it's Lancaster County. I think it's like the Piquet Valley area down along the Susquehanna.
Yeah.
It's surprising to me because I think of southern central Pennsylvania as farmland and flat fields. It may be one of my favorite hikes because of the diversity.
Are you serious, Mike? Everywhere you've been on the East Coast?
There's waterfalls, there's rock formations, there's the Susquehanna River, and then there's these caves, which I know I'm going to mess this up, but they are like one of only two caves in the entire country that were formed and... The way they were formed, I think the rocks separated and split, but it's like people from other areas of the country actually come to explore these.
It sounds like a
I just came across it. I didn't know anything about
it. You didn't even know that day that you went out?
No.
Going to happen?
I saw the sign and it piqued my interest. So.
And you were there with Peri, and did you? I mean.
And there he goes.
Holy crap, folks. Look at that.
It's like there's the cave,
and
he's heading in.
He's heading in. He goes in.
He went right in. Now, there was a point where he had to stop because of getting up over a ledge. I explored a little further, and he waited, and
out we went. This is a hidden gem. I mean, like,
it is. It was.
Were you? Was anyone there when you were there?
No, not at the time I was there. Yeah.
Perfect. Yeah. And, okay, I think I remember asking you this at the time. Did you have a phone? Did you have a cell phone? If you got stuck in the cave, could anyone know? Could you say, hey, I'm here?
So I did have my phone. I don't know if I had service or not, but I was very mindful because this cave, there is a section where you get down on your belly and crawl through to a much larger opening. I did not do that because I was by myself.
Okay.
So the area I was, I mean, there's always risk that something could happen, but...
So people actually crawl through that cave on their belly.
Yeah,
through.
Yeah.
And he stopped. Did he get there before? Was that a different kind of...
To get to that, you had to get up over a ledge.
Okay.
Where he wasn't able to get over that, so okay. He didn't
go
through
Peri.
There. Yeah,
that was
yeah.
smart, honey. That was but very smart.
Interestingly enough, my wife was just asking me a birthday idea. Mine's coming up in June. She wants to get me one of those beacon locators.
Oh, good.
I'm not sure if it's for me or if it's for Peri. I think she worries more about him. But,
oh, yeah, okay.
So, even though she just allows us to do and explore, I do realize
she worries.
She worries. So, yeah.
You know. Yeah. So. Of course. Oh, my gosh, that cave. And that's called what, Mike? It's called Pequa Valley?
I think, yeah, it's Pequea, I think is how it's spelled. And there's a trail network down there, and it's, I mean, there's some very nice, moderate trails, and then there's some that
really?
I think the whole network might be 18 miles from
start
to finish.
I'm a moderate. I can't do the hiking up rocks.
And there's beautiful streams and waterfalls, even on the short hikes.
Nice. But I love it.
Just some more of the wildlife. There's a cliff overlooking the valley that the buzzards and turkey vultures hang out on. So.
And he's just calm about this.
To some extent, yeah. When he sees wildlife, he usually pauses first. Most wildlife that he's not familiar with, which has been very beneficial because we have come across black bears where you can read your dog's body language. You know, and again, he's usually ahead of me. So when he freezes and the tail goes between the legs, you realize this is not happy.
This is
something's
important.
Going on. Yeah. So I was able to get up and put the leash on him right away and saw the two bears crossing the trail.
How far away, Mike?
Maybe 30 yards,
Whoa.
Roughly.
That's close. Two bears.
Yeah. Yeah. They were bears, but they were small.
Yeah.
But still.
Still.
Was great because he paused. Yeah, he didn't chase after him. We've come across porcupines, which those scared me more than any other animal we've ever come across.
Is that
for
right?
obvious, well, I shouldn't say obvious right? reason, but yeah.
Because of the quails coming into them. And
because they're small.
Yeah.
So it's not, you know, a large bear or even deer. He pauses when he sees them, I think, because there's a size element to it. But with a porcupine, that, you know, waddling down a path is, I think, could be inviting. So luckily, the two times we've encountered him, you know, after a very stern no, he froze and I was able to stop him from chasing him. But
he's so attentive to what, you know, you two are such a partnership out there in nature.
If there's one thing that I've worked on, which I need to work on some more, a little more refreshing, is his recall.
Yeah.
You know, for that reason,
yeah.
because I do let him off leash, and
uh-huh.
I realize there's risk with that for
yes.
many reasons. And probably the biggest concern is coming across other people with dogs.
Yeah.
Because, you know, you don't, he thinks every dog is his friend. Every dog, every person he encounters, he wants to meet him. But obviously not all
it's
dogs
not like that.
Receive
yeah.
that, especially when there's one running at him.
Yeah.
So that's the one thing I've been very mindful of and cautious with.
Yeah. Wow. Porcupine, huh?
Yes. We've encountered several snakes, thankfully. The only time...
Yeah, I remember you telling
I've only encountered one rattlesnake, but he was not on the trail. We were actually in the Jeep at that point. We have encountered black snakes and lots of garter snakes.
He doesn't ever try to, like, just go up to
No,
him.
He
you
actually...
Catch it.
He actually will oftentimes run right past them. I don't know if he just doesn't see them or if they're just of no interest.
It.
Yeah,
how about his
you would
scenting?
Think.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. Really, the only thing, I say it's his arch enemy, are squirrels. I think it's like 837-0 is the score. He has, but he doesn't give up.
No.
That is the one thing that he will just take off, and there is no command, there is nothing I can do. He's off and running, and I mean, he's through the brush, over logs, under trees. He's chasing them.
Really, rabbits? Yet to catch him. Not rabbit. Squirrels.
No, tell you the truth, I don't think not many rabbits. As crazy as it sounds, I don't think I've ever encountered a rabbit while hiking. Now that you ask,
oh my goodness.
He's never. Yeah.
But, does he seem like a bird dog too? Like what he is? You said a bird dog.
He's chased some turkeys already. He almost caught a pheasant one time.
Okay, I would
that
say
we had
he's fast.
Snuck up on, yeah, and he lunged in midair, missed its tail feathers, which.
Peri, you're something else, honey. You are.
So he definitely has his prey drive and is still there. But
he's a dog.
Yeah. And deer, he's almost oblivious to. You know, we see him quite a bit being
where you
near
live.
An oldie. I mean, he'll go out in the morning and he'll see 8 of them walking through the yard. And we live in a development, but they're walking through the area and he'll just stand and watch them while he's peeing. And
really, we'll talk about
doesn't
the
distract
the
them, yeah.
Directionals. You want to talk about that while you're talking about the directional of the
directional poop.
Mike has learned something very interesting, and we were sharing it before this show, and I think as we talk in the world, things are interesting, whatever. It's just an interesting observation, and then you look and you dig. What did you find out? You mentioned this to me, and I was like...
You know, every dog has their routine, their habit, whether it's laying down or when they're going out to do their business, they do their circles, they turn, they do whatever. And I noticed that the majority of the time, he would, no matter where we were in the yard, he was always facing north or nearly north. And I thought, this is bizarre.
Yeah.
And when we would go hiking, you know, I know when the sun's coming up, it's on the east. And I noticed usually when we'd go hiking very early into the hike, you know, after a few mile or a mile or so, he'd have to poop. And it's like, he's facing north again. Like he would turn around on the trail if we were heading south and face the other direction.
I have to watch
and
for this.
Of course, curiosity, I had to Google it, and apparently there was a study done in, I think, the Czech Republic or Germany with like close to 100 dogs, and they cataloged every pee and every poop, and they found that dogs, like many other animals, have an instinctive understanding of the magnetic poles and the north-south orientation. And they found that it was very common that most dogs either faced one direction or the other. The way they termed it was their spine aligned with the magnetic pole in the north-south orientation.
Okay.
Which, again, I thought either he was just strange or I was seeing something and
making
something
it
wasn't.
Yeah,
right, but
is this real? Yeah.
But it's just those little escapes from reality. So rather than seeing the news, I'm researching about why my dog looks north when he poops.
I think we're all going to start, after we hear this today, we're going to start to observe our dog's direction and go, darn,
and my,
it is north.
My neighbor did the same. We talk a lot in the morning. We bring the dogs out at the same time, and he started noticing his dog doing the same thing.
So they're going to tell us something if the magnetic shift happens in Earth. We're going to know, folks.
Yes.
Just like, you know, tsunamis, animals know. So
yeah.
They're very,
I mean, and it makes sense, right?
It
because
does make
all
sense.
The ocean animals, the birds, their navigational habits.
It does.
It's like, all right, they've got a sense that
they've got something
we either don't have or had and lost.
And we lost, maybe. Yeah.
But
very interesting.
So, yeah. The thoughts you have while you're clearing your head in the woods.
Exactly. Well, you know, that's why we try to shut it down. You know. What else do we have?
So again, just some of the things we experience, the different things that we observe.
Okay.
Train bridge.
Wow. You know,
man-made waterfall, but nonetheless still beautiful.
Wow.
And of course, he gets excited anytime he's near water. The energy
that's
level
beautiful.
Goes up.
Yeah, okay. Does he play? Does he get like real playful if it's shallow? Is he like
running
around like a goof?
A lot of times, I just love that one. Shades of Death Trail. It sounds much more difficult and sinister than it is.
Say the name again.
It's Shades of Death
Trail. Oh, Mike, where was that?
I think that's up in the Lehigh Gorge area. There is nothing you could go out in a pair of tennis shoes and hike that now.
Oh,
it's not
okay.
That crazy.
And they call it Shades of Death?
I don't know where the name came from, yeah. But it's a beautiful trail right along the water,
nice,
a lot of waterfalls.
Oh, that's nice. Oh, my gosh. Look at that. Yeah. That's stunning. Stunning. He gets to enjoy that. Oh, my goodness.
Favorite time of year to hike because there's...
Tell us why.
Very little people out on the trail. And don't get me wrong, I'm a social person. I love being around groups of people, but again, when you want to just get out and escape everything, it also is just quiet. Yeah. It's very peaceful in the snow. It absorbs all the sound, and you get to see animal tracks. I mean, you'd be amazed at the amount of, like, I've never seen rabbits, but snowshoe hare tracks. The
is
deer tracks
right?
are, you can't, you lose count. There's so many.
Snowshoe hare. No,
yes. I didn't know what it was.
Yeah, I'd have to look it up, take pictures.
My dad's friend is an avid hunter and showed him and he knew right away.
Oh my goodness. That's a great shot. Oh, I love it. Now, is that a pinnacle again or is that?
Yeah, I think that's Pulpit Rock, which is on the way up to Pinnacle.
Beautiful.
But there you can see a little bit of snow on the ground. And again, he's basically in just his, the orange hunting vest that I keep on him most of the time.
Beautiful, Peri. You're one lucky dog. Where are we at?
Just more mountain climbing, more rocks.
Ah, okay. There we go. Oh, my.
Just some of the goofy pictures you capture while you're snapping
great.
With the iPhone.
Isn't that great? Oh, I love it.
Suspension bridge.
Oh, wait,
so, you know, a little bit unstable.
That? Oh, I
forget
on
exactly
spot.
Where that one is.
Is that Virginia or West Virginia?
No, this is Pennsylvania. I forget the name of the...
Is it up north? It's like a northern...
It's actually, I believe, out towards, like, Michaux State Forest and out South Central, like down by the York-Carlisle area.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, I think that's where this is.
Okay.
I've lost track, to be honest, of all the different hikes.
Well, I know. You have so many in your head, and we should document all of them.
Yeah.
It's so cool.
But it was just interesting to me because, you know, a suspension bridge is not stable.
No,
you know, every step,
okay.
It's... I was surprised that he got up there and went right across.
You know what, Peri, you're braver than I am. I'm telling you that. Yeah, you are.
Yeah.
Okay.
That train was not moving. It was parked.
Okay.
But of course, you know, you come out of a trail and it's
look at him, brave
something
soul.
New and exciting and, you know, let's go check it out.
Oh. Now, where are we here? Look at that.
That's
that a real, what's that?
Yeah, so Bald Eagle State Forest, which is beautiful up above Penn State and State College area.
It's beautiful.
It's I think it might be over 1 million acres of state
what?
Game land.
Oh, my goodness.
There's several hundred miles of roadways through it, like forest roads and stuff.
Wow.
And,
don't you get lost when you're doing a big place like that? How do you?
No, when I take them, I say off-roading, but when the Jeep, doing the trails, I do have some maps, different apps that I use on the phone.
Oh,
one in particular,
okay.
All Trails I use for a lot of the hiking. And,
You
know, and it's nice because leaves the breadcrumbs so you can find
so
and follow
your
trail
stuff.
And you can always track back if you need to. Yeah.
Okay, All Trails.
Yeah.
Okay.
But yeah, that was an old train bridge that, they restored and it's kind of cool because it makes a bend. So as you can see, it's dark when you get into it until you make the turn and see the light out the other side.
Oh my. Oh, I love that. That's so cool.
As you noted, my two favorite hikes are either waterfalls or scenic lookouts, you know, up
well,
on
it's
higher
beautiful.
Elevations.
Beautiful, and he loves it too, obviously.
Yeah.
He's right there.
Yep.
Loving it.
And just some of the interesting things you find in the middle of the forest. An old steam engine type excavator with the bucket and shovel
oh
in the front.
Oh my gosh, it was just abandoned there?
Yeah, that's actually in Michaux State Forest. It's called the General. Because it was General equipment. So on the back of this, you actually see in large metal letters, General.
Oh, my gosh.
And, of course, you know, that's something for him to go explore.
That
but that's,
is very
I mean,
cool.
You're 5-6 miles into
the
forest
trail.
At this point where you come across this. So it was an old, I don't know what they were mining. I don't think it was coal in that area. So I'm assuming some
there.
Kind of a war. Yeah. I mean, things been there for probably 100 years.
Oh, my gosh.
And navigating, leading the way at Blue Marsh.
I love it. Certainly not.
And
afraid.
As soon as the kayak comes out of the garage,
like,
he's
ready. He's like, where are we going?
He's like, are we leaving?
I love that when I saw it. Oh my God, that is. I'm ready to go, Dad.
And that's pretty much where he stands or lays the entire time we're out on the water.
That is amazing.
That's your My daughter was home from college, so she enjoys coming out with us and doing these hikes.
Oh. They're all good. What are we looking at?
This is just rock climbing guideline.
Okay.
There are some cliffs there, but you just kind of get an idea of how steep and, you know, the areas, and he'll scramble right up the rocks.
Yeah, we're going to see a video, folks. I can't believe it. Yeah. It's just adorable. Wow. Where were we here?
That's Bald Eagle State Forest. Okay. Yeah, just one of the elevations.
Wow. Oh.
And just that is Penn's Creek, which is apparently huge for fishing, like trout fishing, and people come from all over the country to fish that. But the water is just crystal clear.
Is it really?
But my son laughs because one of the first times we went out, you know, when he gets hot, this photo is exactly what he does. Whether it's a stream or a puddle of mud in the middle of the trail, he lays in it to cool himself in his chest. And he walked up to a puddle, and as soon as I said, "Don't you," he just stared me straight in the eye and lowered himself into the mud. And my son talks about that constantly because
because you didn't listen. You were already made your mind up, honey.
You had to cool off.
You've already made your mind up. Oh, what are we looking at? Oh. Oh, my gosh, he's so cute. So. He's a real dog.
Again, there's more of the creek just in the snow.
These photos should be in Fido Friendly or Modern Dog or where are we going?
This is that same train bridge or tunnel, just the other end of it.
Okay.
Obviously, a different time of year in the snow. And afterwards, you know, just laying in the back of the Jeep.
Yeah, Jeep,
cushion,
folks. That's
relaxing.
Perfect. A Jeep to take you on these adventures. We pulled into the station. I posted on our Facebook page the yellow Jeep that you have. And he's flying around with you. I mean, it's a perfect car.
Yeah, and it's
perfect transportation.
It's the weekend toy, so it don't really care
something
about how dirty he gets it, how much air gets in it. But it's nice because we'll do, like, I do go off-roading to some of the parks. I'll take him on some of the more mild trails, and it's interesting because he's more tired after a day of that than doing a long hike. I mean, we've already done 22-mile hikes, and of course he was exhausted. That's the longest we've done.
Oh my gosh.
But in the Jeep, I think what it is, because he's stabilizing himself in the back. You know, it's kind of like you and I. It's more tiring to stand still all day than it is to walk. And so if I don't get him out for a long hike, a few hours in the Jeep, and he's pretty well spent.
Isn't that something?
Yeah. But it's nice, too, because, again, Bald Eagle, we can go up and ride the trails, drive them, stop somewhere, do a 2 or 3 mile hike, get back in, go some more, get out and do more. There's times that, you know, we'll let him out of the Jeep, and I'll drive down the trail, and he just runs.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
It's almost like you intuitively know what he needs. Like it's like, I think this will, like, it's just like that bond without speaking, you know.
Yeah, you start to read their body language. Yeah. You recognize when they become anxious, you know, and he'll let you know.
I don't think you can doubt that bond, folks. Do you have the video? Did we finish the photos? Do the video?
Yeah, we can go to that.
Is it there?
Just him playing
in
the snow.
Or did we finish him yet? Oh, we're still... Oh,
we can get through these. Usually I sit down, and that's the first thing he does. He comes over and
it's kind of like a thank you, love you.
Yeah, yeah. He just wants to come over, and again, the Velcro dog, as he's doing right now.
Yeah, I know. I see it.
Climbing on my lap.
I see it.
All right, so this is one of the videos. If I can, Peri, give me a minute.
You're knocking me off there. Oh, there's the video. Is the sound on for that, guys? Is the sound on? There's a really neat sound.
Oh, there it is, yeah.
Yep, good boy. And this way, up here. Come on. Yep, good boy. Thank you. boy.
He did it. Yeah. That's awesome.
So that's up at the Lehigh River Gorge and part of the Appalachian Trail, but it's,
you know, steep.
Like I said, it's steep. And yeah, sometimes a little bit of reassurance and motivation, coaxing, and he'll go right up.
Yeah, yeah. Very sweet. Very nice. And you have one getting in the water or trying to get out of the water.
Yes.
This is a cute one.
So normally when I bring him back into the boat, again, with the kayak being flat, yeah, I'll get down on my knees towards the front. And then, much like you would if there was a person trying to get in, you kind of get them under the front shoulders and you just lean and drag them right up in. But this one day,
huh?
He just, yeah, decided he was wanted to come in a different direction. But
see, sounds he just on loves that one. It's funny. You're like, oh, no, nobody.
Don't come over here. Oh, no.
So not that way, buddy.
You could see how close we were to the shore.
Yeah.
Normally what he does,
close.
He will jump in, run over to the shore, and uh-huh, then he just runs through the water where it's, you know, chest deep and
I
runs
gotcha
around, and then I'll paddle over and he'll hop back in. If we do go out into the middle of the lake, usually he won't jump in the water until he's close enough to shore,
sure,
where he's like, all right, you know.
He's a smart boy. But you know exactly how to handle
day,
that.
That day, he just felt as though he was
coming
in the boat.
Exactly how to handle that. You're amazing, Peri. That was a wonderful journey.
Yes.
I mean, every time he comes in, we're like, where'd you go? Where were you? What do we know? And if we have time, we can share. It's awesome,
yeah.
Mike. Any other words of wisdom, and we can just summarize. Yeah, see, we talked about a first aid kit. We talked about what you take. Hey, snake bites. You didn't have that, right?
Yeah, I haven't had that. But yeah, basically.
Energy bar. Food. How do you take raw food on a hike?
So, I know it's not your favorite product from Answers, but the pig's feet.
Oh, the pig's feet. Oh, they're fermented, folks.
They're fermented. And they're basically split in half and frozen.
Oh, yeah.
So, I'll take them along, and it's great for travel because it's firm and solid, and by the time it becomes lunchtime, it's usually thawed and we'll stop and he'll eat. If we're going to be out for a long day, I always get the patties from Answers, so I'll just take a frozen one of those in a small cooler, and I'll take that out. And
or if you're on a long hike, you have a
it's
backpack,
thawed.
You have a backpack?
Yeah, taking a backpack, or I'll leave the food in the Jeep, and then when we get back, you know, it's thawed out and he can eat.
He knows how to do it all. Some people say, oh, it's raw, I can't figure it out. But he does. He's so athletic. He's just so athletic. Such muscle there.
He keeps me active, that's for sure.
There you go, too.
Yeah.
Isn't that the truth? Oh, my
yeah
goodness. Let's see. Ride equipment, we talked. Hydro, life preservers, and what it's done for you. GPS, flares, cell phones. That's what I always think about.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know. Dog moms, when we pack, we're like, oh, I think I need a flare in case I sitting in the middle of nowhere, or
right,
or a GPS, or my cell phone better work.
Come
this
save
guy's
me. Yeah.
Going. He's just going.
Yeah, yeah. He often leads the way, and it's interesting because there's a few times, you know, animals, and I guess with the scents and everything else, they naturally will follow a trail.
Yeah.
Well, sometimes those trails turn out to be like a deer trail or some other game path, and if I'm just lost in the moment, just walking, there's times that I'll be following him and then realize a mile later that he took me on a wrong turn somewhere.
Oh,
and
no.
It's like, this is not the trail.
Hey,
we turn around and backtrack and head back. But,
oh, that's when nature takes over.
Because normally he is spot on.
I
use the app, but he knows where the trail is and follows it for the most part.
He got you lost.
Yeah.
Yeah, you did mention, folks, that we'll just reiterate again, Mike uses All Trails app. It's free.
Yep.
And when you're hiking it, you can see where you're going, right? And
yeah,
you can go back to it. It'll save those hikes then?
Yeah, you can download it so that if you're not connected to cellular, you have the map on your phone, and most smartphones have GPS in them. So it works for that. You can, if you want to track your activity levels, whether you're hiking, running, mountain biking, whatever, you can set that and it'll tell you, you know, calories burned and
show you
whatever.
Where you were.
Yeah, yeah.
And a beacon. We talked about some things here. I mean, like, I always bring things along because, you know, I'm thinking of everything.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I don't know. I'm going to get get in my own way. But like, this is a reflective. They can put it over their necks if it's getting towards dusk or something. Oh, yeah. I brought one that's not. Okay, there we go. Oh, there we go. Well, anyway, yeah. It shines up bright. Or yep. You say you use the beacon.
The like little, the night eyes that you guys have. Yep. Yeah, they're like a quarter and they blink.
They blink.
So I'll use that. So or they can stay on solid. So I'll put that on
so
them,
you, have that.
You know, early in the morning.
And then he mentioned first aid kits. You can get them all kinds of places, you know. Yeah. There's little packs that you can stick right on your belt or a bigger pack. I always think about snake bite or Benadryl or something to take swelling down if they get into a beehive or something.
Yep, yeah. Also, just keeping, I mean, I think most people do these days, but having your vet's phone number in your phone.
Excellent.
You know, because of... you hope you never have to call in an emergency,
but if you do, you think about it ahead of time, right? And I'd ask Mike, folks, this is so cute. I'm like, well, you know, there's really a fun product, Arc Naturals. It's a nice company, highly reputable, but don't worry, don't rinse me. It's just a soft summer breeze, waterless type of shampoo refresher because he's out. Like, you're out and everything. He said, I don't want that girly smell. I don't know. What did Dad say when I said, "How, you know, do you have to bathe them before you go home? Does the family go, oh, here they come?" And you said...
That's what creeks and lakes are for.
So, we're using nature, right?
Yeah.
We're naturally just rinsing off, just naturally, right?
It's actually another trait with the breed. They're actually a very clean dog. They will groom themselves, much like
right?
a cat.
Is that right?
Yeah. And they also, I don't know, the oils in their skin they have...
Just repels?
There's like this almost sweet smell to a Vizsla.
Nice.
It's very unique. I mean, even when he gets wet... Yes, there is a little bit of a dog smell, and of course, if he's you know rolling in mud or something. But normally they just naturally clean.
Well, I'll tell you what. I knew the hour would fly by. I hope those of you watching really enjoyed our glimpse into breaking away and regrounding and the bond.
And I can honestly say that I would not have done that without him, because he changes the way I look at things. He changes the speed at which I do things and kind of, although my kids yell at me because I hike too fast.
Yeah, I would imagine.
Although
I can't
moving fast, my mind has slowed.
It's slowing.
You know, because I'm just watching him and I'm just seeing things through a different perspective.
There we go.
And it's what it's about.
Dog is family, and that's what it's about. And Mike, it was a joy. And thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Honored
Peri.
To be here.
Oh.
After all these years of...
I've been trying to get him to blog and, you know, tell people and blog and all this stuff. So at least we got him on BCTV. So thank you so much, BCTV. Thank you for our show. And we'll be back next month with more topics. If you have any ideas, email dogisfamily@godfreysdogdom.com. I love to hear from you, hear your stories of enhancing your life with your dogs. All positivity, all... A special bond in today's world, for sure. Thanks again for joining us, and we'll see you next month.
Dog is Family on Berks Community Television is underwritten by Answers Pet Food.
Dog is Family on BCTV is supported by Godfrey's. Welcome to Dogdom.